Hey everybody, Ron here. Today I wanted to talk about a game that I've discovered recently. It's called the Index Card RPG. The Index Card RPG is by Brandis Gilhelm of Runehammer Games. He started a channel back, I guess, in 2015, 2016, something like that. Created this D20 game that is simple, flexible, yet very powerful. The basics of it, you all know, if you've played Dungeons & Dragons, you have 6 stats, you roll a d20, you add a bonus, you compare it to a target number, and there you have it. But this is where it gets interesting. There's a lot of neat little innovations in this game that just blew my mind when I first read about it. So one of the things I want to talk about is there are 3 kinds of actions in this game. There are simple actions, there are checks, and there are attempts. Simple actions are things that you ought to see that, like the trivial things that you shouldn't need to roll for, like starting up an engine on a starship or fixing a saddle on your steed. Those things provide no drop. Why roll for them? Your hero should be able to do that, no problem. Now, where there is danger involved, where there is a consequence for failure and there is reward for success, you want to roll a check. And that will be what you normally do. You roll a d20, add a bonus, and you compare. If you meet the target or exceed, you succeed. Otherwise, you fail. Like leap over a gap in a dungeon. Or you want to use lockpicks to open a door. Now, attempts, this is where things start to get really interesting. Because attempt can be something as simple as rolling the attack. And then if you hit the monster's armor class, roll damage. But then you can use attempts for other things. Like you can have your rogue trying to get out of a complex lock and give the lock hit points, like say 10 hit points. And then you roll, and if you succeed, you roll like a d6 or something like that and whittle away at the hit points. And I've never thought about anything like that. It's so simple yet intuitive. You know, we have other games that have skill challenges and whatnot, and this is so simple, so familiar and on one hand, but elegant on the other hand. Another thing that's innovative is the whole concept of a room target, or I like to think of it as a scene target. Instead of, you know, you have, you know, the armor class for a monster, you know, or a DC to pick a lock, or a DC to swing off the chandelier, the whole scene has a target number. In this game, you typically are looking at 4 target numbers, 10, 12, 15, or 18. Those target numbers can be modified by plus or minus 3. Minus 3 if it's easy, plus 3 if it's hard. And that's basically it. As Tracy Hickman in the Extreme Dungeon Masters Guide says, we're not trying to calculate a rocket trajectory. We're just playing a game. A point or two doesn't matter much. And so this game embraces that concept. Plus 3, minus 3, that's about it. Now, there's some exceptions to that rule, but you know, that's the basic gist of it. As I mentioned before about attempts, you roll, that's a roll for an effort. That's what damage is. And, you know, basically are using tools to overcome a complex challenge. For example, you know, you may have a scene where you're trying to convince the queen to go with your plan, and you don't want to make it a simple check. You know, maybe you set her target at 15, you set the effort threshold at 10, and then you know someone rolled their charisma. If they make the charisma, they roll a d6, and they make progress towards that. If they are, say, a skilled orator, or if they're just a Jed from the farm, maybe they just roll a d4 because they're not trained in speaking. Maybe they're really good at speaking, like they're a bard with a well-trained bard. Maybe they might be rolling a d10 or even a d12. Another concept that's interesting, the concept of hearts. You know how in video games, in a lot of video games, you have hearts for hit points. Well, this game uses the concept of hearts too. One heart equals 10 hit points. Most monsters and other things are represented in the number of hearts that they have. 2 or 3 points may not matter here or there. You know, if you go from 1 heart to 2 hearts, that there's a big jump in the challenge. You know, is going from 7 to 9 a really big challenge? No. But going from 10 to 20, that's a big challenge. When I'm talking about the concepts of this book, this is something that you may or may not like. This is something that speaks to me for the most part. And so that's why I'm doing this video about it. The movement and distance is abstract in this as well. Instead of measuring inches or feet, you have close, which is within a normal melee weapon range. You have near, which is you can get there in one move, or far, which is you can get there, but the only thing you can do to get there is move. You can't do any actions. And then beyond that is out of range. I am used to abstract combat from playing a whole lot of Fate. This is something that speaks to me as well. I like abstract distances. I feel like it's a nice medium between square-by-square tactical combat and theater of the mind in depth. When you hit 0 hit points, you roll a timer. You roll a d4 and you die in that many rounds. But like in D&D, you roll a d20 death save, except it's not a three strikes and you're out system. It's just to see if you roll a natural 20, and if you roll a natural 20, it's a miracle. You get a hit point and you're back up. And then finally, the game has an in-game currency. D&D has inspiration, and Fate has Fate points. Savage Worlds has bennies. This has a hero coin, and you can use the hero coin to make a reroll or add a d12 to your d20 roll. You can give your hero coin to another player. And that's just the basics of the system. And there's so much more to it. The system is loot-based. You do have some milestone rewards that you gain from time to time. But for the most part, you acquire power in this game by getting all different kinds of loot, which will appeal to a lot of different types of people. People like being rewarded, getting that special item or two is definitely a reward. Now, one of the complaints people might have about this game is that it doesn't fit long-term play. Well, you'd be amazed at how much this game supports long-term play just in its base system by gaining loot. But for those of you that's not satisfied with that, there's even a more complex milestone system that you can use that will support more long-term play. So even that is covered in this game. If you can't tell, I really like this game. Is this something that my current home group will play? I'm not sure. I'll give it a try sometime here in 2022 and see how it goes. I'm hoping that it goes over well so I can replace D&D 5th Edition, which is a fine game in and of itself. And there are aspects about it that I like. Actually, the engineer in me really likes the crunchiness of D&D 5th Edition. I've played crunchier games. There's even an advanced 5th Edition out there, which some people think is mind-boggling, but I absolutely love because it appeals to perhaps a different crowd than the ICRPG appeals to. But I like to consider myself an Omni gamer. But anyway, I'm not here to talk about that. This game is great. Go check it out. The ICRPG.